Friends, welcome to a new session. Today we are going to discuss about the elementary particles. What are elementary particles? How the elementary particles were discovered? What is the history? What is the tale behind the discovery of the elementary particles? And then we shall proceed towards the properties of the elementary particle. So let's see what are elementary particles. So elementary particles are basically all the micro elementary constituents. That is, they are not able to be visible through the naked eye. So they are microscopic elementary constituents out of which all are responsible for making the matter in this universe. So elementary particles can be regarded as the microscopic elementary constituents out of which all matter in the universe is made up of. So let us discover or let us study what is the history, what is the story, what is the tale behind the discovery of the elementary particles. Till now we have known the elementary particles, that were proton, neutrons, electrons and the photons. So everybody is well aware of the four elementary particles. So let us again recall what has happened till now. So Dalton, in the 19th century, he was the first one to propose the atomic hypothesis, tell about the atom, that atom is the ultimate constituent of the matter, every matter consists of atom. So on the basis of the Dalton theory, J.J. Thompson in 1897 had proposed the watermelon model, in which he had said that there was a nucleus and electrons are the seeds of the watermelon. So he regarded as electron as the fundamental particle. Then successively Rutherford and Bohr had given the circulation of the electrons in the specified orbits around the nucleus. So they had told that the nucleus is a positively charged and they are surrounded by the negatively charged electrons, and these electrons are not like the seeds in the watermelon as proposed by J.J. Thompson, but it was revolving around the nucleus in definite orbits, in specified orbits and definite permitted orbits. So then Rutherford had again gave his theory, he had imparted a betterment of the theory in 1919 and suggested that the nucleus, which was positively charged, assuming to be positively charged as the atom as a whole is neutral, he proposed that the nucleus consists of positively charged particle protons. And then successively in 1922, it was Chadwick who had given the next fundamental particle, that was the neutron. He had discovered the neutrons. So till now, till 1922, three particles were discovered: electron, protons and neutrons. Successively, sidewise also, the photons were also discovered, and these photons were the quantum units of radiation. It was the building block of the electromagnetic radiation, and also it was the carrier of the electromagnetic radiations. How the electrons, if excited to a higher state, comes down to a ground state, the photons are released. So the photon brought a revolution in the quantum history also, and the photon was the quantum unit of radiation. So successively till 1922-25, four elementary particles were well known to everyone, and they had never thought that there exists any other particle also. But Dirac in 1930 predicted the existence of positrons, and in 1932 Anderson had experimentally verified these positrons. He experimentally discovered the positron, and this positron was regarded as the antiparticle of the electron. Okay, so a positron was the antiparticle. So that was the condition that when electron is made to remove off from a particular nucleus or from a particular atom, so what happens, there is a vacancy created inside the atom, so that vacancy would be regarded as a hole, or it was given a name as the positron. So Anderson had experimentally verified the theoretical predicted existence of positron by Dirac. Then in 1931, simultaneously, Pauli had also given a theory of the neutrino hypothesis. aware that in the beta decay, when a neutron is being converted into proton and electron, then in association with the proton and electron, another particle, that is a neutrino, was also exposed off. It was also disposed to balance the mass conservation and the energy conservation. So the Pauling 1931 gave the theory for the existence of the antineutrinos and neutrinos. And Yukawa in 1935 proposed the strong Yukawa forces, and according to the Yukawa forces or the meson theory, what they said that the protons are positively charged, neutrons are neutrals, and since protons and neutrons are residing inside the nucleus, so there must be some strong attractive force which must be able to bind the protons and neutrons. And if it was not the case, then how come a positively charged proton, there could be Coulombic repulsions, how could the protons reside inside the nucleus? So Yukawa in 1935 had proposed the pi mesons present inside the nucleus, and Anderson and Nedelmay had experimentally discovered the pi mesons, where pi mesons were found to be of the three types, that is pi positive, pi negative and pi naught. And you already know that the meson clouds are surrounding the protons and neutrons, which are responsible for the attraction between the proton neutron. Either it could be a proton proton neutron neutron, or it could be a proton neutron. So what happened, that these pions decayed into mu positive and mu neutrino, and pi negative meson is decaying into mu negative meson and a mu antineutrino. The neutral pi meson decays into two gamma rays, because the decay time is very very small, so it decays into two gamma, and the gamma, if having quite a large amount of energy, approximately 1.02 mega electron volt, then it is able to internally convert into electron positron pair. So this is how it is happening. A mu positive meson breaks into positron and electron neutrino and a mu antineutrino. Similarly, mu naught, mu minus is decaying into electron and a mu meson and a electron neutrino. Mu neutrino and a electron neutrino. So from these reaction, due by these decay processes, we are able to detect the mu mesons, electron neutrinos, its antineutrino, mu neutrino and its antineutrino. So more elementary particles were detected. But in 1950, what happened? When they were studying about the cosmic ray showers, and when they found that when the high energy particles in the cosmic ray showers were striking the lead plate, and the particles were being recorded in the cloud chamber, so in the cloud chamber detection, they observed that there were V-shaped tracks found. So these V-shaped tracks were found of two neutral particles. So the first neutral particle was called as lambda, and this lambda decayed into a proton and a pion. So, and the second track consisted, second V track, the V track had a second line that was called by the second neutral particle, which was called as a K meson or kaons. So the first track was showing of the particle lambda, and the second one was showing of the K mesons or kaons, and these also subsequently decayed into pi positive meson and a pi negative meson. So two more particles were detected, that was the lambda and the K mesons. Similarly, other particles were also detected by other scientists, which was sigma, xi, cascade, omega. So there were many other particles, and till now more than 200 particles are detected, and still the research is being continued and more new particles are yet to be discovered. So we can see that the list is endless. So we shall subsequently now see what are the basic properties of these elementary particles, what is the basis of the classification of the elementary particles, and what conservation laws do these elementary particles conserve or not, whether they are conserving the conservation laws and not. So we shall be discussing about the antiparticles. What are antiparticles? Antiparticles are similar to the particles, where they would be different only in some of small properties, like they would be have the same mass, they would be having the same isotopic spin, but they have opposite charge, they have opposite strangeness number and like that. So initially only the particles were discovered, but as the time advanced, the antiparticles also started to be discovered. And then what we saw that all the particles that existed in the universe had its own antiparticles also. So we can say that there is a universe of antiparticles called the anti-universe, antiparticle universe, or it is called as the anti-universe. So what is antiparticle, you know now? So the first we can say that the antiproton or the negative proton were discovered when a proton was made to strike a target having protons of very high energy, and the energy that was found of the target was approximately equal to 6 giga electron volt. So when the target of having such a high proton was striked by a proton, so then it liberated a proton and a antiproton. So in this way, in the laboratory, we could prepare the antiproton also. And we know that the positron is the antiparticle of the electron. So students, don't confuse between the positron and antiproton. They are two different particles. So when this antiproton that was created here, P bar, was created and it was made to slow down, so the slowing antiproton and the proton annihilated together. So always remember that the particle and the antiparticles are always created in pairs and they always annihilate in pairs. You can see here and also in this reaction, a proton and antiproton are created in pairs. And similarly, if this is a reverse direction, reverse process, so proton and antiproton will again annihilate in pairs, and also they will be created in pairs. So next, slowly we could discover neutrino, antineutrinos. We had also discovered a neutron and an antineutron, electron, anti-electron called positron. So on the parallel lines, all the particles that were discovered had its own antiparticle, and we could say that there is a universe of antiparticles called the anti-universe. So now if we come to the relationship between the particles and antiparticles, here we have summed up the properties that are having the same relationship. So the particle and antiparticle possess the same mass, their spins will be same, their mean life, the time in which they decay, the particle will decay in the same time as well as the antiparticle will also decay in the same time, and the isotopic spin will also be same. So the relationship that they exhibit in pairs, so the particle and the antiparticles are always created in pairs and also they annihilate in pairs. So annihilation and creation is always in pairs. The relationship that the particle and antiparticle possess of opposite sign means the signs will be opposite, but the magnitude of the value of the relationship is same. So the opposite sign relationship is exhibited by their charge. So if a proton is a positively charged, antiproton will be negatively charged. If the electron is positively charged, this antiparticle, that is positron, will have a negative charge. So the charges are of opposite sign. The magnetic moment values are same, magnitude is same, but the direction will be opposite. The strangeness number will be positive for a particle, then it would be having a negative value. The magnitude will be same, but the strangeness sign will be different. So it will be positive for particle and negative for the antiparticle. And similarly, if it is negative for a particle, then it will be positive for the antiparticle. And the particles or the antiparticles which are bosons possess the same parity, means the parity will be even for the bosons, particle antiparticle, whereas if the particle antiparticles are fermions, the parity will be opposite, so that we can call that the parity will be odd parity. So we can say that the bosons, particle antiparticle, have or they obey the even parity, and the fermions obey the odd parity. So this is the relationship that the particle antiparticles exhibit, and we have seen that there is a whole lot of galaxy consisting of antiparticles, and the universe is called as the anti-universe. So meet you again. Thank you.